Good morning, everyone. A warm welcome, everyone, to the second day session of Refresh Batch on DISA AT course examination. I welcome to the today's speaker, sir, R. Vittal Raj Garu, and our ex officio and regional council member, C. Chengaletti, sir, and our branch chairman, J. Srinivas Rao Garu, and Vijayawada chairman, C. A. K. Poonchandra Garu, and Kakinada chairman, V. Sachinar, K. Sachinaran Garu, and all other members also. Now, I request CAK Poonchandra Garu to give his opening remarks, Vijayawada Chairman. Sir, over to you, sir.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Chairman of Guntur Branch, J. Srinivasrao Garu, Regional Council Member and Ex-Officio of Guntur Branch, C. A. Chengaletti Garu, today's resource person of day two of this refresher course, DISA 80 assessment test, R. Vittal Raj Garu, Kakinada Branch Chairman, Sachin Garu, and all the participants, a warm good morning to one and all. Hope everyone are safe, doing good at home, and your family members also are being safe. On this note, the outset, let me take this opportunity to congratulate Guntur Branch for taking up such a wonderful initiative to equip the knowledge with, and impart the knowledge to, especially to youngsters or whoever not yet cleared their DISA examination, which is of utmost importance today's bank audit scenario, or be it in the knowledge wise. I am sure Chengaletti sir might have taken crucial part in this, along with the program director Prasanna Kumar Garu. I must appreciate Guntur Branch for coordinating, not only coordinating on their own, but coordinating with along 13 other branches, including us. And I have seen yesterday Ravi, secretary of Guntur Branch, typing that 60 from participants are from almost 66 branches. So it shows that it is a very thumping success of this. I mean, yesterday even I have joined the program and I have followed for quite some time. And members are very, very enthusiastic and they are asking questions to Gopal Krishna Raju sir. I am sure next 5 days also is going to be a knowledge feast, along with the experience what Vittal Raju sir or Paul Jagar sir are being will be carrying upon. Taking this course through. Friends, apart from that, I would like to take one more minute and update on what we are doing at Vijayawada branch. We have conducted a few plethora of programs on four corners and on accounting standards with the Central Committee of ASB. Okay. And we have also conducted 6 days practical aspects of GST program. So we have Vijayawada YouTube channel, and along with Guntur also, Guntur branch also has YouTube channel. So if you want any one of us can listen and get enriched with that knowledge, please log into that channel and you can view the programs being uploaded over there. And also we have conducted a 4 successful vaccination drives, administering almost more than 1200 doses being Covaxin or Covishield to Vijayawada branch members. Of course, few members from Guntur are from Rajahmundry also have come and administered doses over here. And we are also conducting 4 camp tomorrow, 5th. We are also conducting tomorrow 1 more camp, sir. So I request all the members to utilize this opportunity. And before I conclude, once again, I appreciate Guntur branch for taking such an wonderful program, for taking this initiative. And I request all the members to stay safe and stay healthy, because we have seen quite a few members, not only from our branch, from CA fraternity, they have departed us suddenly, they have parted with us suddenly. So I request to be careful, third wave is also around the corner. So I request everyone to stay indoor do programs virtually, provide services to our clients virtually. Unless until necessary, please do not venture out. Okay. With this, I thank Guntur Branch for inviting me to say a few words on this occasion. It's over to you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Now I request K.V. Sachinaran Garu from Kakinada to introduce today's speaker for the address gathering.
Thank you, sir. My name is C.A. Kandapur Sachinaran, Chairman of Kakinada Branch. Now I'm going to introduce today's faculty, C.A. R. Vittal Raju. C.A. R. Vittal Raju is a risk assurance and cybersecurity controls professional and trainer with over 25 years of experience working with clients in a wide range of industry verticals on IT governance, cyber security, privacy, IT assurance, enterprise risk management, and risk-based internal audits. His qualifications are FCA, CAA, sorry for interruption, I got a phone call. His qualifications are FCA, CISA, CAA, CISSP, CGEIT, CASM, CRIST, and CIA. He is a member on the RBI Standard Committee. Very sorry, I'm getting phone calls. He is a member on the RBI Standing Committee for Cyber Security and IT Examination and a member of IRDI Information Security Group. He has earlier served for two terms as the International Vice President and Director on International Board of ISACA USA and was awarded with the President's Award and a Certificate of Appreciation for Outstanding Contributions during his term as Director. He has also served on Research and Technical Committees of ICAA India, IAEA Florida, ISACA International, ICWAI, GC member of MCCI. He is founder and senior partner of Messrs. Kumar and Raj Chartered Accountants, leads and manages the Information and Strategic Risk Assurance Services practice across diverse business verticals since last over three decades. With this, I am presenting C.A.R. Vettelraj. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Sir, over to the speakers for the address gathering, sir. Over to you, sir. Sir, unmute, sir. Please unmute.
Should I start?
Yes, sir. Please start, sir. Please.
Okay. Good morning to everyone. And thank you for the kind introduction and first invitation to be part of this particular program. In fact, it is a long time since I have been handling DISA classes due to other commitments. When Mr. Dr. Raju invited me, he asked me to handle the session. He's a very close friend, so I couldn't say no. And I must say, Dr. Srinivas Rao, chairman of the branch, he has been meticulously following up and very closely interacting on this. And I must thank him for this such a great coordination and type. I'm sure all of us, even though we are home, we would be busy with quite a lot of things, especially from home. The productivity reduces to 75% or 50%. So that's the whole problem. And thanks to everyone. I think CA Mr. Ravi Teja, secretary, and all the chairmen of the various branches. My apologies, I may not be recollecting the names of everyone, but please treat this as my acknowledgement of everyone who has been part of this. So coming to the subject directly, I'm sure yesterday you have had a very good introduction in terms of what this course involves and you know what needs to be done. And I'm also quite positive that many of you have gone through the study materials and I'm sure many of you would be in advanced stages of preparation is what I would like to think. Not only that, it would have been told yesterday, but I just thought it is important to understand that when you are doing a program like ISA, DISA, now it is ESA. Now, one thing we have to understand, this is not only a test of your knowledge, but also some element of skilling. But one thing which many people forget, it is also a subtle test of English. Because I'm sure those of you who have solved the questions, you might see that many of these questions, they are, if you are not careful in reading the question, you will completely go wrong, right? So you need awareness and being obviously an objective type examination, it is very important that you clearly have a strategy of how to attempt this kind of paper. If you keep on clicking and going, obviously you'll land up, God forbid, in unwanted results. So the good thing would be that you have to kind of also develop that strategy for the examination. Otherwise, it is going to be quite tough as such. Reason being, what happens typically is many of them simply think that, okay, they can click and get away. No, you can't get away like that because there is a significant amount of marks that are involved. Therefore, you have to be very, very careful about what you are doing. Having said that, I just want to check if you are able to see my screen.
Yes, sir.
Is it moving?
Yes, sir.
Is the screen moving?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Thank you. So one important submission, I'm sure as every faculty would have told you, the idea of this entire course is more of a refresher. So it is not the idea to take you through every element of the background material. I'm sure all of you have this background material with you and the course content, whatever was given. You have to understand that many of the things which have already been, I'm sure, covered as part of your detailed course, here we are not going to touch upon each and everything, but I would encourage any number of questions. I have, of course, certain coverages which, from my perspective, which I thought would be important for you to prepare. So I would be highlighting on those. Now, just to let you know that it is my privilege to have been associated with the ISA or either the DISA course since its inception. I did the first examination, then I was asked to become the faculty. And myself, Dr. Janakiraman, I don't know how many of senior members would know, Dr. Janakiraman, Mr. Ramanathan, and Matthews, four of us used to go crisscross the country and take classes in every corner of the country. So that is how those days were. And so that was 2011. I think we have come a long way now. And in between, as I said, I had taken a hiatus from DISA, and I have been focusing on several other aspects, which are more at a regulatory level and also at an international level. But all said and done, our CA Institute obviously is close to heart, and DISA course is very close to heart to me, because I have been part of the IT committee and prepared several materials, several questions, been evaluator. So all that has been a very good experience, and trying to help what ISACA does and borrow the experience and see how we can make our course better. Of course, there is a long way to go, I would think, looking at the material and whatever it is, but the content keep changing. Right, let's get into this. So as you know, today we'll be discussing on module 2. We are going to discuss for about 2 hours. So this event is till 10:30. While I have a commitment at 10:45, so I'll have to leave by 10:30, but I'll be available for any questions offline. So please don't worry. You can always feel free to ask me questions either through WhatsApp or Gmail or whatever. Right. Having said that, I think it's good. I must congratulate the chapter. They also opened a WhatsApp group, so which will make it very easy for you to interact with the faculty members. This particular module, or this particular chapter, is on a very, very significant aspect. This, as you know, this module covers governance, management of enterprise information technology, risk management, compliance, and BCM, right? Now, I would think of all the modules, this is one of the most driest modules and involves a lot of English, lot of management science, and governance. So many of you who are reading through that would find it a little boring. I'm sure you are done, I guess. So that is unfortunately one part of it, but we have to understand the nuances in this particular module. The answering of the questions has to be done with utmost care. Reason being, English matters a lot, especially in this particular module. And the meaning of the words are also important. So I know some of us may not be as proficient in English, which is fine. I would think that you should do a very deep dive with a dictionary in hand or with your Google dictionary and make sure that you are understanding the concept behind each of this. Let me tell you a very simple example. What is the difference between effectiveness and efficiency? Now, many of us keep on using this interchangeably, but mind you, there is a significant difference between the two. So it is important that you pay attention to such English words which we have been using over years, but now it is a process of unlearning and relearning. Similarly, what is the difference between privacy, confidentiality, and secrecy? So again, if you take these three words, they sound very alike and everybody thinks it's all the same. It is not the same. Each of them has a completely different connotation. So this is just an example how the proficiency in English, to the extent of your understanding the questions, is important. So I would think, please do make sure that you are adequately prepared, because without English, obviously you cannot do, answer this question. And if we, there are two choices which are the closest, which is how generally all these questions are, you would certainly get foxed on that in spite of knowing the concept. So let us get into the module. Now, as you will know, the module has 5 chapters. The first chapter deals with concepts of governance and management of information systems, which is quite an important chapter per se. And this kind of brings in significant amount of attention on this word governance, which we use so frequently. Chapter 2 deals with GRC frameworks and risk management practices. Again, drawing from the first and going into the practice of GRC is where this comes in, which introduces to you to various popular frameworks across the globe and the importance of a risk management practice and how risk management and GRC are very, very closely linked to each other, because the R represents risk management and that in turn is closely linked to governance as such. The third chapter deals with key components of a governance system. It talks about if you are going to implement a governance system, or if you find that an organization needs a governance system, which of these are extremely essential and what makes up a good governance system. So it is very important from a practitioner's point of view to be amply clear about this. Chapter 4 deals with performance management systems, and performance obviously is one of the key things which is neglected in governance, because, for example, how do you know that a board is performing well? Now, that is where the question started long back, and Jim Kaplan, a person who professor of management science, he then further looked at this entire thing and he said that we need to do something about it, and that is where he came up with a system which we'll discuss. Then chapter 5, or the last chapter, deals with again a very important area wherein you can have a lot of questions, which is business continuity management, right? I'll stop in between for questions, but I think we will simply go because there is a lot to cover, and we'll certainly take up important questions. I'll not be taking each and every question during this session, since time is the constraint. Let us start with overall understanding of why a chartered accountant needs to be involved in something like information systems audit. First of all, I am sure you understand, if you pull the server plug of any organization today, there is no books of accounts. Let us be very clear about it. So once the books of accounts are not there, you know what are the implications under law. Then only whatever we have to do, our raw material is books of accounts and information. If we don't have that, what are we going to give an opinion on? So fundamentally, please understand that an organization's breadth is information. And in fact, as a statutory auditor, as an external auditor, what you audit is nothing but a quality audit of the information. The information that is produced to you, you put it to various tests, A, with regard to integrity, completeness, accuracy, and B, with regard to compliance with certain statutes, standards, requirements. And that is where you make up your judgment and form an opinion, and you give your opinion. So that is something which we need to understand today, that even for an external financial auditor, the IT aspects form a significant part of these controls. And especially when you are looking at an application software wherein you don't see what is happening inside that software, obviously it is important for the auditor, because every figure that comes into the balance sheet, profit and loss account, obviously comes from those systems. So obviously the internal controls surrounding financial reporting are equally important. So that is where I think you need to also understand. The last but not the least also is the understanding of the governance and management of the enterprise. And today IT is a fundamental part of the enterprise. Therefore, it is important to understand the governance of enterprise IT, or what is called as EGIT, enterprise governance over information and technology. Let me take you through one case study, which is, I would think, a very important case study in the history. This, of course, happened in 2014. In US, as you know, they celebrate this Thanksgiving Day towards the end of the year. And that is actually marked by huge sales right across, wherein you get 80%, 90% discount on your most popular products. There is obviously a run on most of these stores. And I'm sure you'd have heard about one of the very popular stores in the US called Target chain of stores. It is a very, very popular chain of stores in US and also in some other parts of the world. Now, what happened on the Thanksgiving Day of 2013? Target suffered a significant cybersecurity attack. So how did the hackers try to get in? Well, Target has not put in some controls. They had put in some controls, but they were not properly aligned. And what typically happened in this case was that the hacker got through a particular vulnerability, a weakness in one of their portals through which they deal with their vendors. And he was able to install a malware on each and every POS system across the store chain. So you know what is a POS system, wherein you swipe your card or tap your card and that's what gets the information through and your payment gets done. Now what the malware did was, before the POS machine could take this information and exchange it with the internal servers of the organization, the malware would first collect the credit card data, which would obviously include the 16-digit card number and whatever PIN the person is supplying and the expiry date, etc., etc., quite a lot of details. And all that was passed on back to the hackers. So this was done very quietly and there were no controls to detect all this in the organization. What was the damage? See the damage. It is mind-boggling. There was 40 million credit card numbers and information of customers which was taken away. 110 million customers' personal information was stolen. It has been taking several millions of dollars for Target since then, even today, to fix those problems. There has been 34% fall in their sales immediately after. There was a 5% fall in the share prices. There were several lawsuits, as you know, in US, the privacy lawsuits, which are happening. Most importantly, the brand equity of Target got dented. But for the first time in corporate history, the CEO of this organization was asked to go because of poor management of controls and risks. Now, this is very important from a governance perspective to keep in mind. Now, we are discussing one aspect of overall IT, which is security. Now, you have to understand that quality is also an important part of IT. Because, for example, when you are booking your railway ticket, the application should behave as it is expected to behave. And when you are putting in an information, obviously the computation of tariff or whatever rules are applied has to be appropriately done by that software. So all that also falls as part of quality, and obviously the delivery entirely has to be ensured. Then, of course, there is aspects of security with regard to this entire transaction set. Obviously, you need confidentiality, as you know, that every information cannot be shared with everyone. And that is where there is the principle of need to know and need to do. Then there is also the second important principle of integrity, which involves what changes and how they are made to any state of data or instruction set. And that is, again, a very important aspect. And third and last but not the least is availability. Whenever you want to do business, you have to make sure that the IT systems are available to you. You go, for example, to pay some of your dues and you go to your cash ATM and you find that it's not working and that's the last date for payment of, let us say, a child's fees. You seriously have a serious problem. So obviously it's important that when it comes to service delivery, IT today is a platform. Now look at this governance. What is this governance all about? every organization, if you see prima facie, will only do the object of achieving maximum profits. But is that the ultimate goal? Well, you obviously, every enterprise is here to make profits, but it is also here to grow. And growth is not merely simply making profits in one small piece of time and running away, because you cannot sustain. And that is where it is important, if the organization is really look at making a difference to the lives of people, it has to look at the stakeholder perspective. And that is a very important tenet of governance. For example, let me take an example here. If you are a customer of a bank, have you ever asked the question when you opened the account with the bank, or even afterwards, are you a safe bank? You never ask that question, because when it is a bank, it is implied to be safe. So this is a very important foundation in a stakeholder relationship, the stakeholder here being the customer, wherein as an enterprise, you are required to ensure that all the risks of IT, of course, the enterprise, have been appropriately managed. Look at regulations. If you see, everything is electronic today, e-filing, assessments, everything is going electronic. Now, in this case, obviously, there is no hard copies anywhere that we see. But the question also remains is, because of the fundamental inherent risks associated with information technology, which is the right copy of the return that was filed? Because you could have digitally signed one for, return and done another one. That's a reason for ensuring better governance. The departments themselves are ensured you can only sign at the time of submission. So therefore, your information gets recorded as part of that. And obviously, there's a responsibility on both sides, both the SSE as well as the regulatory authority on this. Then, of course, there is also the competition, which is continuously trying to see if you are bad in governance, they will take over and they will obviously take your market share. Having said that, in this target case, you saw the amount of impact that had on an organization. So as I said, one of the dimensions of IT governance is IT security. In fact, the larger domain of IT security also comes under IT risk management. Because IT security has so much to be done, so it is treated as a separate domain by itself. But if you largely look at it, IT security is nothing but making sure that what is not supposed to happen does not happen. That's all. So that is where, if you look at this, you have IT risk management, which is also part of the governance. And you know that you have compliance, because when you say governance, risk, and compliance, all these three go together as an inherent aspect of good governance. So having said that, when let us say you have a risk which materializes, let us say in this case, there was the cyber attack. Imagine the damage that the organization suffers. In this case and many other cases where organizations have been attacked, you will see the kind of losses, financial side. You'll see, of course, money being lost. I'm sure you are seeing so many customers losing money, so many banks losing money. Last to last year, as you know, two banks, one Cosmos Bank, which is one of the largest banks in Maharashtra, and a 12-year-old bank, they were completely robbed. And mind you, the hackers took away within a matter of just hours, 74 crores, okay? And similarly, City Union Bank also suffered losses, significant losses arising from this. So monetary assets today are the targets of most of these hackers. There are also financial penalties, as we know, because compliance is a very important requirement. So the penalties comes from regulators, comes from contractual stipulations. So all this does come in as part of that. And that causes obviously financial damages to the organization, which results in the bottom line being affected. Then you have legal expenses, lot of investigations that the organization has to take up to find out what happened, fixing expenses, as we have seen, to fix all these problems, insurance costs and loss of stocks. But on the other side, you have intangible losses like reputation damage. These are more dangerous than financial losses. You have intangible losses like reputation, brand equity, loss of market share, then loss of loyal customers, then you become a target for increased inspections, the employee morale goes down, the directors start exiting, cybersecurity attacks start increasing, and obviously this is a right time also for rivals to spy. So this is to tell you that so much of damage can be caused if IT is not properly governed and manage. So this is an excellent example of why IT governance is so important, because generally what we do, let us take a very simple thing, your mobile. How many of us clean up our mobile contact list? How many of us clean up our SMS list? We never do that. We only going for a larger mobile, simply have all that kachada as part of this. You never use, never see in your life. And you also pay for that, because obviously the service provider is very happy. The more data you put online, they are very happy with that. So very important, please, to understand that everything costs money, and silently, especially in IT. And it is very important to govern and manage as many of it. So if you see, governance starts from the personal level, the way that you are even backing up your data. You think everything is going to Google Cloud. How do you know? Have you checked? We don't care to check. So processes are also very important, inherent part of controls, which is also part of good governance. Technology, of course, is, and obviously people are. So people, process, technology is a very important combination. Now, this example, this particular schematic will give you how to understand IT governance. As you will see on the right-hand side of your screen, an organization is there to meet its business objectives. Now, for achieving this business, so if you take a bank, bank offers retail banking, wholesale banking, corporate banking, and several aspects. So what is the idea? Each of them is there to serve a particular segment, meet their needs, and in turn, the organization grows. But then if you look at each of the areas, for example, a simple thing like savings bank operation, it has got a business process around it. But if you look at the core of this business process, that is where your information is as a customer. The bank's business information, like rules with regard to lending or NPA classification, etc., all that forms an information. And today, where is that information actually getting processed and residing? It is in the IT of the organization. So this is something which we have to understand, why as auditors, we need to understand that today's enterprises are completely surviving only because of IT. In fact, if you pull off their IT, those organizations would die. For example, take your mobile banking or ATM. Do you think that the bank can survive if all these dies today? Or can you even survive? You cannot. So all that, we have got used to that. If tomorrow morning they say we have stopped all this, you go back to counter banking, 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. you do counter banking. I mean, this is no more a given, because today most of the banks have been shutting down their branches. Now, this is where the stakeholder comes in. The investors who are invested in the bank, the customers of the bank, the employees of the bank, the government, the regulatory authorities, the vendors, the society, everybody has some interest out of that bank, directly or indirectly. And this is where it is important to understand whether each of these stakeholders' expectations are being met. Now, what happens when an IT risk happens? Now look at it. If you see, when we say IT, you got application software. For example, when you are doing mobile banking, there is a mobile banking app. Then information, obviously, your customer information, the bank's information which processes and with your customer information provides you services, all that is a fundamental requirement. Third is infrastructure. Obviously, you need a mobile equipment, then you need the network, then obviously the bank has to set up a huge infrastructure. All these are also foundations for delivering IT services. The last but not least, the people who are managing that, right from the CIO to the last person in the organization who is trained to serve you. All these are very important people who are making this IT happen. Now, this is where the problem comes. There are threats to IT. A threat could not necessarily be security alone. For example, somebody pours water by mistake on the server. So you can imagine what could be the damage that the server has, and the entire data could be gone. So there are several risks that need to be managed. Or let us say a particular application software which has been built by the bank, instead of debiting, it is crediting those accounts. So you can imagine what is the damage it can do. Or simply to say that there is delay In fact, some sites, if you go, they keep on taking such a long time, what is called as latency. So that is also a risk. So each of them is a risk. So we have to consider that there is an impact on every risk that could materialize to the organization. So that is where, please understand, there are threats which could be in the form of hackers, which could be in the form of people who are committing errors, which could be in the form of natural disasters, which could be a form of this pandemic or whatever. And these threats, what do? They create situations or make the controls vulnerable. I'm sure you know that because of not going out, now you suffer from several kind of psychological, some of them suffer from several kind of psychological problems. Some of them could be enjoying at home. But then even that, when a person is psychologically weak or when a person is sitting at home, in fact, during this pandemic time, there have been lot of number of attacks on mobile banking because many people are trying out mobile banking for the first time. And obviously the hackers are trying to entice them. Somebody calls as a bank manager, somebody calls something. So all these are part of the exploits. And that obviously impacts IT. It then in turn impacts information. It in turn impacts this business process, how they are performed. And in turn obviously impacts the result of how the business objectives are met, how the stakeholders are served. So please understand it is a full cycle. That is the reason we say that risk and reward are the two sides of the same coin. Similarly, governance has to make sure that they are continuously creating value for the stakeholders while balancing the risks. And that is what this entire module also talks about. So now I'm sure with that context in mind, you will be able to better appreciate these five chapters. Why I took this time to really explain this was so that from a practical perspective, you would find that, okay, this is what happens to an organization when something goes wrong with regard to even IT, right? So once you understand that, you'll be able to very clearly see that, okay, what does this concept mean? You'll be able to understand that. So always relate to real life if you have to understand anything. If you read even a 1,000-page book on how to ride a bicycle, you can never ride a bicycle with confidence. Only if you sit on the bicycle and at least try once or twice, maybe fall down once or twice, that's fine. But that is how you can learn a bicycle. So it's very important as auditors to become very conversant with information technology. Auditor minus digital knowledge in the future will be extinction. So please be clear about it. And governance will play a critical role wherein you can have a huge practice in governance itself. So please be prepared for such opportunities. Now, let us look at the five chapters. We'll go one by one. So let us take the first of the chapters, which is concepts of governance and management of information systems. Now, there are certain key concepts which you will have to very clearly understand. I am sure most of you have read through that. I'm just going to only discuss certain aspects of these. So look at 1.2 here. Of course, I am missing out 1.1 because 1.1 in your middle is nothing but introduction. So if you look at this, it introduces the topic of governance, etc., etc. What is governance? In fact, when you talk about governance, there are various aspects of governance or various types of governance, if you can say. These are what some of them are given here. Enterprise governance, corporate governance, business governance, and if you really look through all this, each of them has its own aspect. Now you can further divide it into quality governance, information security governance. So there are several aspects to be governed. So what does this word governance really mean? To understand it in a very fundamental way, I would take an example. I am sure some of you might have traveled in a passenger ship, or at least many of you would have seen this on YouTube or movies, how a passenger ship looks like. Those of you who have watched the Titanic, you know what a passenger ship is clearly, right? Now, the passenger ship, you will understand, some of the passenger ships can take up to 3,000 people, right? Now, let us please understand, how does the passenger ship work? The passenger ships, if you look at this, it has got a whole organization which is running the ship. There's a whole amount of staff because there are people who have to take care of the technical aspects of the ship, which is the fuel, which is how the mechanics are working. how the rudder is working, how the navigation systems are working. So there's a whole lot of work to be done on that. Then there are also significant amount of them who are taking care of various supplies like fuel supply and aspects with regard to spare components, etc., etc. All that has also been. So there is a tremendous amount of stores which has to be managed on the ship. Then there is the hospitality or the customer care. They're in taking care of customers, their needs, etc., etc. Then there is cargo management. So there are a whole lot of people who are actually staff of that particular ship who are actually working to make that particular mission of that ship happen. Now, one of the key persons who is part of the organization of the ship, who rather heads the ship, I am sure you know, is the captain of the ship. But ironically, if you closely look at what does the captain do, you'll be surprised that the captain is the person who physically works the least. You agree with me? The fact, captain actually doesn't do any work. But if he is not there, the entire mission of the ship will fail. Why? I mean, let us look at what kind of decisions the captain makes. Number one, the captain has to be continuously evaluating the external and internal environment. For example, let us say the ship is going from Singapore to, let us say, Dubai, right? On the way, they get a call saying that there is a huge consignment which is available in Chennai, and that would bring in huge profits, obviously, to the vessel. So would you like to pick it up? So you see, there is an opportunity management also that the captain has to make, the decision he has to make. Now, the decision once he makes, that's a big decision, and we'll see why. Let us take one more aspect. Let us say there is a huge storm that is coming, and he sees in the radar and is informed by the various authorities that there is a huge storm on the way of the ship. So what does he have to do? Now, obviously, he has to take a deviation from the normal course of that ship. Now, what does all this mean? He can give a command saying that, no, we are going to go like this, or we are going to go to Chennai. But mind you, can he do that, take that decision without consulting the entire team? Why? Because suddenly then this guy who is managing all the fuel will come and say, we have only fuel for so much, the ship will stop in between. So it's a very important decision. That has, so I'm just giving you one example. There will be several suggestions, or they may say the food for the people will run out because it is going to take so much extra hours or so much whatever. So very important to understand that the first job of the captain is evaluating the external and the internal environment. And when I say captain in the organization, it is equivalent to the board of the organization, the senior management of the organization. The senior management of the organization also is, whether whatever be your business, is constantly looking at opportunities and threats which are continuously coming up, both in the external environment and the internal environment. Now, what do you mean by risks in the internal environment? Suddenly, let us say the CEO quits. You can imagine that's a very major issue for the organization. So that could cause a significant problem for the organization and a lot of damage. So that is where, if you really look at evaluation, then direction. Based on evaluation, which involves a lot of analysis and discussion, then he gives the command to the management of the ship. The person who is managing fuel, the person who is managing, everybody comes in there, as I said. This is equivalent. This management is equivalent to the executive management in the organization. So you got the CXOs, you got the senior managers. All this comes as part of what we call as the executive management. So obviously he gives the direction to them. And then what is the job of these management fellows? To achieve those directions. And that is where, what do they do? So we saw that the captain continuously evaluates and then directs the ship, directs the team. And then after that, the team takes over, implements those directions. So that is implementing is where it comes under the management science parlance of PBRM, plan, build, run and monitor. So what does it happen? For example, let us say a bank says that we need to now have our own mobile banking application. There's a whole lot of work to be done. You have to plan for what is your architecture. You have to look at what is the type of customers you have. You have to then appropriately arrive at the appropriate architecture for your mobile app, integration architecture, safety, security, quality of customer experience. Everything comes in there. It's not easily done. It involves a significant project involving several partners, several vendors to do a mobile banking launch. But when you do that launch, please understand they are planning, they are building out this application on a continuous basis. They are running that application and monitoring to make sure the aspects are being appropriately kept up. And if there is something which is going wrong, they need to take action. Now, what does the management, is the job of the governance over with simply evaluating and directing? No. After direction, once it is being performed, they will evaluate what is the outcome from the business perspective of the business mobile banking application. They will see whether at an enterprise level, at a stakeholder level, what is being met or not. So that is where, please understand, enterprise governance always is done, whether it is a small enterprise or large enterprise. Only thing, you may not know how it is done. In small family-run enterprises, they may not use the word governance, but they clearly know if you have to go and buy something, whom they have to approach, who will issue the money, where from they should go, what should be the right thing for the organization. Everything is known. So it is unwritten governance. So every enterprise has its governance, and governance is all about meeting the stakeholder expectations while making sure you are achieving your growth objectives. So that is the best way to run an organization. That's why enterprise governance is on top. Then you have corporate governance. Why did corporate governance come in? If we really look at the history, I'm sure you read about the Enron fraud and the kind of large frauds that took place across. That is when in US and many other countries, they brought out an act called the Sarbanes-Oxley Act. I'm sure you might be aware, right? Sarbanes-Oxley, what was the purpose of Sarbanes-Oxley Act? Nothing but take a stick and tell these managements, you are not doing what you're supposed to do, which is enterprise governance. But obviously they only put certain aspects because it's a mandate. And that is what comes as part of the, in our country, the Companies Act since long time has been pushing corporate governance through various aspects. So we have been in a way front runners because we took our act only from the British. So the UK kind of system we have been following and expanded on that significantly. So we are looking at corporate governance wherein a statute or a law tells you that this must be done, right, with regard to governance. So this is where if you see all our corporate governance requirements, SEBI requirements, etc., everything is focused on corporate governance. If you do not comply with corporate governance requirements, you will have to face the consequences of law. Whereas in enterprise governance, it is not like that. Enterprise governance encompasses corporate governance. But beyond that, suppose you are not giving the goods at the best prices. Unfortunately, only competition determines that. There is no law which says that you shall have only so much profit. You can't do that. The next thing is business governance dimensions or performance dimensions, wherein obviously you have to understand that. I mean, let us understand one thing. When you are traveling in a flight, okay? Have you ever visited the cockpit? If you look at the cockpit, there are so many dashboards, meters. Some few 50, 100 of them at least. I only seen a couple of times a cockpit. And mind you, it is amazing. I was always thinking these fellows, two fellows who are running this flight, how can they look at all this? But like in your car, there are certain indicators which should not come on. For example, should the brake light come on? If the brake light comes on, which means there is danger. Your brake is not working. So when things are going fine, there is no need for a brake light to come on. When the brakes are not working, you have to make sure that you understand that there is a problem with the brake lights coming on. So it is important to understand the business governance also involves performance and measuring performance. So everything needs to be measured at the process level. But for you, how is the performance of the flight? Do you go and look at those meters? No. You simply say, how was my journey? Oh, it was very comfortable. They took care of me very well. This landing was soft. We reached on time, took off on time. So that is a business outcome. The stakeholder expectations being met. So this is the difference between business outcomes and performance metrics, right? But performance metrics are very important to ensure the quality of business outcomes. Because if you are having such a soft landing, there is a person who is well trained sitting at that particular place who is monitoring all these gadgetry and exactly knows at what speed he should come down and at what elevation he's come down. All this is so much of work that he has to do. So this is where this comes in with regard to that. Of course, we look at certain other aspects as we go through that. Next important aspect also we'll be discussing is with regard to corporate governance and regulatory requirements. Then with regard to a very important topic called as enterprise governance of information and technology, which comes from a document called COBIT from ISACA, OBIT, which actually is today a front runner with regard to IT governance. Then a very, very important aspect that we'll be also discussing is enterprise risk management systems. Now, so I already explained the difference between enterprise governance and corporate governance. And what is governance over enterprise IT or IT governance? Why do we need it? What are the benefits it delivers? That also we have seen. Very important is, please understand, in most organizations, the lot of effort is put in making the software. The IT team will work with a whole army of software development professionals for several months. And when they deliver this software, the business fellows will say that, no, this is not even meeting our requirement. So where is the problem? When initially the software did start, there was some interaction. Now that is where governance questions start taking shape. Who was involved right in selection of the project? Who was involved right in selection of the team who should decide on the project and aspects of the project? How to select the vendor? Who selected the vendor? What were the terms of reference that were given to the vendor? How did they come up with the requirements? How did they come up with the cost of the project? How did they look at the integration with various other existing aspects of the organization? All these aspects need to be looked at from somebody. And because these aspects are not forming part of the framework and these are not part of your organization structure, the problem happens. So governance is significantly also about two important aspects. One is meeting expectations, having the right kind of organization structure to deliver it. For ages, unfortunately, the IT departments have been in a mess. In fact, always, traditionally, if you see, the accounts department and certain business department, IT, they were never go together. They are never peaceful. They are always fighting, right? This fellow will say, trial manager is not tallying. That fellow will say, no, we have done whatever you wanted. Don't ask me. I don't understand what is trial balance tally. Right. So this kind of fight keeps on going on because there is lack of common language and what needs to be done is not properly understood. That is where the role of committees comes in, wherein you got multidisciplinary people coming onto the committee and looking at it and taking a decision there. So I already explained about EDM, evaluate, direct and monitor, which is the job of the captain of the ship or the boardroom or the board of an organization. Now, obviously, IT governance also puts in a framework in place. Now, what is this word called framework? See, who can take the strategic decisions in any corporate enterprise? Needless to say, it is a board of directors. Because why is it so? Because it is laid down under law. But if it is not laid down under law, and if any person were to take that decision, you can imagine what is a mess that would happen to the organization. So it is very important to define a framework which says that when it comes to direction part, this is the agency or the organization within the organization will take that. And how do you make sure that this all this is working properly? Obviously, you need an executive management which will make sure these directions are implemented. So their job is to implement all these directions. So there is a role of this executive management to do that. Then how do you make sure that the objectives are actually achieved in the right manner? So you have monitoring or audit, which also oversees all this. So if you look at this, there is a framework in an organization. You have the board, you have the executive, you have the operational staff, then you have the support departments like the risk management department, the compliance department, the accounting department, etc. Then you have the internal audit departments. Then you have the overarching audit committee. So if you really look at, there is a very clear framework. Today, any public enterprise, any enterprise which has gone public, or any enterprise comes under the Companies Act, you know what are the requirements of this framework. So similarly, for IT governance also, there is need for a framework. Who shall do what? What all need to be done? And how will it ensure that the expectations of these stakeholders are met? So that is exactly what broadly governance of IT would deliver, to see that your customer experience is good. Then role of monitoring assurance, obviously, as I said, plays a very critical role, because that is the independent kind of the role of the section of the organization which focuses on independently looking at whether whatever these guys are doing is the right thing to be done and whether that is happening as per required. Then please understand, you cannot measure anything, you cannot have a successful journey unless and until you know two things. Where from did you start? Where you have to reach? Unfortunately, in most organizations, every person thinks we have to make profit. But what is going to sustain your profits? Nobody thinks. So that is why it is very important to have something called as goal setting. And it's a very detailed process, because again, you have to look at external environment, internal environment. What are the strengths? What are the weaknesses? Who are the competitors? Where is the entire world going? What is the technology? You have to look at several aspects. I'm just naming a few. So the goal setting comes in, wherein you set goals at every level, at the enterprise level, at the board level, at the management level, each process level, you start setting the goals. And these goals obviously are turned into objectives, which are most specifically achievable aspects with regard to every process, department, or whatever. And then that needs to be measured. Please see one thing. Suppose you are traveling in a bus and somebody comes and asks you, sir, where are you going? You say, I don't know. What will the other person think about you? He'll say some problem with this fellow. If you don't know where you are going and you are traveling, there's a serious problem. Unfortunately, many organizations are like that. They don't know what is your goals ultimately, what is your objectives. That is the reason the lack of governance. Obviously, some organizations will rise like a spike and then simply fall off. So this has been demonstrated in the past in several of the products as well. In fact, if you know a product called Ceasefire, it was there, a small fire extinguisher. They sold fire extinguishers very well. But because of poor governance, the entire organization doesn't exist today. Similarly, look at the Tatas. If you look at them, see, they got the kind of business spanning the entire globe. But if you really look at the kind of way that they govern and manage all these enterprises, it's huge. That is where the importance of governance really lies. So you have goal setting and measurement of the goals. Obviously, we are interested. Okay, how many more kilometers to go? How much more time it will take? Because your goal is clear. I want to go to this place. Similarly, goal setting has to be done, and it has to be, each and every goal has to be measured constantly to see, are you going there or not? So that is a very important component of governance. And in IT governance too, it is a very important component. For example, how much of capacity of the server, of the storage, which is your hard disks or whatever, of the communication bandwidth, etc., that your organization will require. Now, look at this aspect. Isn't it related to the business and the growth of the organization? Because that is the reason suddenly we say server is choking, income tax department, server is down, site is down. Why? Because there have been very poor capacity planning. In fact, the latest income tax portal failure is an excellent example of IT governance failure. You are launching with fanfare and the FM is announcing and it doesn't work. Imagine what else can be more, disrupt to the organization. And that is where, unfortunately, several aspects, whether it is vendor, whether it is the design, whether it is whatever, have certainly not been handled well. So that's a classic case of IT governance failure. So there are also several components which you'll see of IT governance, which have to be achieved to achieve IT governance. There are also, as I said, regulatory requirements, which are also among the core of what we need to do. Now, one of the key things from an examination perspective is they may say, okay, to test your understanding of whether you understand governance from a technical definition or not. So some of the definitions are given in your material. Please do go through them. For example, there is a ISO 38500 standard, which is a governance on IT governance standard, which says that the system by which organizations are directed and controlled is what is called as IT governance. Very, very simple definition, right? Then there are other definitions, like it is a set of responsibilities and practices exercised by the board and executive management. Please see, the responsibility is put at the board level. Further what? With regard to the goal of providing strategic direction. What is strategic direction? Where are we going? Whatever we are doing, what will it do for the stakeholders? Can we run this organization on those lines till a long time? So all that is part of strategic direction. And today, let us understand a very simple example of how strategic direction can make a difference. I'm sure you know the story of Amazon.com. Amazon.com, if you know, when it started this business, it was a online bookstore. One of the first successful online bookstore. Till that time, buying a book means you have to go into one of the outlets of Higginbotham's or Barnes and Noble's and you have to buy that. I am sure all of us have bought some book from Higginbotham's at least sometime in our lives. In fact, Higginbotham's is more popular, especially in our railway station, as a meeting point for anybody. Right? But what has Amazon done to these two large organizations? Mind you, Higginbotham's and Barnes and Noble's are hundreds of years old. What did they do to them overnight? They killed these two organizations in a way, because they made the books available online. And what was their total investment, if you see, for Amazon in this? They didn't buy any books. They didn't buy any stores. All they did was what is called as create a marketplace for connecting people. And all it costed them was maybe just few millions. In fact, when they started, their office was only 900 square meters, right? That is how they started. So today, of course, you know that how the world has changed with regard to purchase. So that is a example of strategic direction. Then ensure that the objectives are achieved. So you obviously, if your experience as a customer with Amazon, there are good and bad things. Obviously, you know, the bad things are the ones which are not properly governed and managed. Ascertaining that risks are managed appropriately. Obviously, risks include several aspects. As I said, security is just one of them. Operational risk is there. Then you have strategic risks. You would have technology risks. You would have several aspects of risk. Then verifying the organization's resources are used responsibly. Of course, a very important part of ensuring is that whatever resources you have, they are spent optimally. The same thing applies to IT. Unfortunately, organizations mismanage IT investment significantly. In fact, one of the organizations, they bought a bank. They bought 200 ATMs. Then only they realized that who is going to use these ATMs, because they don't have much of retail customers. They simply copied it from another rival and they said, we will have 200 ATMs. So these are all senseless decisions. So ultimately, if you see, it is a balance between conformance and performance. When we say conformance, not just legal conformance, even policy conformance, contractual conformance, et cetera, comes in as part of it. Now, I already explained corporate governance, but quickly going through that. So it deals with corporate law regulatory requirements as regard governance. And most of these roles are clearly defined under law. You got the role of the CEO being defined, role of the, you know, directors being defined, the board committees being defined, audit committee being defined, controls, assurance, risk, everything is defined. There are also several committees which are mandated. So you must have the strategy committee, etc. In fact, if you look through IT governance stipulations, which have now come, especially with regard to RBI from SEBI, there are very clear directives that every organization shall have an IT strategy committee. They shall have an IT risk committee. So all these are mandated committees, which some of them need to be reporting to the board. And that is where it brings in tremendous amount of corporate governance into this entire thing. And you are required to have independent experts. In fact, certain committees can be only headed by independent experts as directors. So you need independent directors on that. So there is obviously a role of audit committee, which is a key role. And the regulations, you know, you are well aware, you know, Companies Act is one, SEBI requirements, audit assurance, SOX, et cetera, et cetera. So broadly, if you look at the aspect of corporate governance and what all it covers boards, directors, and committees. Now apply all this to IT. Today, all this applies to IT as well. That is why today we break it into not just information technology, but information and technology, because business understands information better rather than technology, but technology has to be understood because otherwise you'll not get the information. So all that is the reason you have several committees wherein the board themselves, if you see, if you look at the board strategy today, if you look at the vision of the organization, in fact, IT is driving the future of the board, the future of the organization. So that is where the boards are very keenly interested in digital. And they are obviously, if you see many of the banks, Gartner says that most of the banks will die as they are today, another 5 years from now. The very banks of the future will look completely different, which is already happening, right? So obviously key to corporate governance is this, and looking at legal and regulatory compliance, like in IT, it will be the Information Technology Act in India or the regulatory requirements from SEBI, RBI, IRDA, etc. Then you have business practices and ethics, which also need to be made sure. For example, you know that there has to be adequate competency, training, etc. of all professionals. Then disclosure and transparency, even in, if you see in system audit, there are significant requirements today from various mandated regulatory organizations, wherein the format is defined, what needs to happen with regard to the controls is very clearly defined, and whether organizations are actually doing their job properly. In fact, regulators today do an independent vulnerability assessment, what we call ethical hacking. Vulnerability assessment, penetration testing to find out if their controls are working properly. And risk and performance management has to be properly managed through organization structure. And monitoring has to be constantly done. And the central to all this is obviously communication amongst all these dimensions of the organization. So all this is defined, if you see, as part of corporate governance. So now, when we look at enterprise governance over IT, so it's an expansion of corporate governance wherein you don't wait for the law to tell you what is to be done. You take it upon yourself where you think that it is a very important stakeholder expectation or in the interest of the stakeholders, and you start doing that. That is the reason you'll find that some of the applications or websites are so engaging because they're trying to make the customer experience ultimate. And you'll find the entire experience is very, 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 very pleasant, right? So from that is one of the aspects of governance wherein the most important stakeholder, which is the customer, is able to see significant benefits because of good governance over IT. Now, while we are talking about this, let us look at some of these key aspects of what is required. For example, don't you think that you will buy the car which is suitable to your objectives of family needs, your growth, maybe your status symbol or whatever? So you are very clearly saying, subconsciously, you are deciding on several factors when you're buying this car, right? So when you're buying IT, for investing in IT, IT technology, people, processes, don't you think there should be very clear alignment between IT goals and business goals? Unfortunately, across history, that has not been there for quite a long time. It is only recently that all this is becoming more popular. So therefore, one of the fundamental achievements or what brings together the purpose of governance, IT governance, is aligning what IT is doing, what the goals of IT are, with those of the business of the organization. Because IT only exists for the business of the organization and not otherwise. But it also holds true that IT can change the very business complexion of the organization if it is used very well. So that is where, if you see fintechs or the today's payment banks, they are so different, you know. And if you really look at some of these share trading apps, I mean, they are so intuitive. Imagine when somebody had to go to the floor of a stock exchange in those days to put a contract through or a particular bid through. All that is gone today, and we are doing everything on the internet. So that all that is because of good IT governance in many of these organizations. So it is important to formalize and implement the right kind of IT governance processes with regard to IT. And when I say IT, there are several aspects of IT. In fact, we'll see them defined earlier, later in this, wherein you are looking at how do you align, plan, and organize your IT for the business. How do you build, acquire, and implement the various IT systems which are aligned to your business requirements? how do you deliver on an ongoing basis to the business with regard to information requirements, service them, support them? How do you do all that on an ongoing basis while ensuring that the business outcomes are being met? So that again an important requirement. And also last but not the least, how do you constantly measure, how do you evaluate, and how do you assess whether whatever are those goals which are set are being actually achieved, whether at the business outcome level or at the IT performance level? So all this goes into the IT processes being there. And obviously when you have process, you need to know who has to do it, because we have a good process and no owner is defined. It is like a, you know, a very nice house which doesn't have an owner, so which is obviously will get decayed over time. So very important that the IT organization, the decision structure, how, who will take the decision, what level, what consultation is also defined for various IT projects. Then it involves the board of directors, the executive management in all IT related matters. It governs and manages the, with regard to govern and manage, they put out the roles and responsibilities of the board, the executive committees, the mandated committees under law, as well as the management. We saw what is the difference between governance and management when we took that example of that ship. Then, of course, establish an IT strategy and steering committee, as I said, so that constantly keeps on looking at, are we doing what business is needing? Then plan, align, and manage the IT enabled investment portfolio. If you take large organizations, there are thousands of projects going on across the organization. And you will find everyone is buying the same thing again and again, rather than optimizing that. So these are all lot of gaps wherein investment get wasted. Mind you, if you really look at the surveys, only 40% of the IT investments achieve their objective. So you can imagine how much of misgovernance is there in IT investment, asset management, IT asset use, and optimization of performance. Next one is to implement a performance system, which will be integrated with the regular processes, and that will keep on measuring whether IT is delivering or not. And obviously establish sustainability through support, monitoring, regular communication. I already explained this. So this is the kind of nutshell of this alignment. Ultimately, a good governed organization has on its focus the stakeholders on top. Who are the stakeholders? As I already explained, who are all the sets of stakeholders? And every stakeholder has a need. When you are going and doing a transaction on Amazon.com, or an Indian Railway site, there is an expectation of a benefit. You are obviously sitting at home and you are achieving the entire reservation within a matter of minutes. And by paying online, you don't move a finger there across that. I mean, you do move a finger, but not really yourself, right? And then, but there are two other objectives which have to be met. Whether the risks while you are doing this are optimized. For example, when you are doing a mobile banking transaction and it keeps on telling you every third one, there is a possible threat. Will you ever go through that mobile banking? You will never use that app. So risk optimization is again a silent expectation or need of a stakeholder. As I said, you will never tell the bank or ask the bank, are you a safe bank, right? So they, you don't ask the bank to prove that you're a safe bank. You're supposed to be safe. And when it is safety, it also applies to IT. So obviously the IT also should be safe. Then you have resource optimization, wherein you make sure that the requirements vis-a-vis whether what resources are used and how they are optimally value is delivered using them is ensured. So all that goes in today into your enterprise goals. So today IT also determines the future of the organization today. If you see the way that Ola and Uber have transformed your travel experience, the cab experience, all that comes because they have looked at IT and said how to change the entire business model, right? So therefore, the IT related goals have to be interlined with the business goals. And obviously, you have the enabler goals, which is a very important thing, which is what we call as components of the governance system, which we'll look at later. So then come to the important topic of enterprise risk management. As I said, risk and reward are two parts of the same coin. So enterprise always means there is risk and reward. So there is obviously when it comes to IT also, there are inherent risks with IT. Hacking, the word itself, we got familiarized only because of internet and IT. Otherwise, we didn't know what was hacking. Hacking in those days meant somebody takes an axe and somebody cuts off somebody, right? So all that is gone today. And if you really look at it, there is now need for balancing the risks with value creation when you are employing IT for achieving your business objectives or internal objectives. So we already talked about these things: benefit realization, risk optimization, and resource optimization. So what does risk optimization do? It looks at your IT operations risks are managed properly, cybersecurity risks are managed properly, IT compliance risks are managed properly, IT strategic risks are managed properly, your risk regard to financial reporting with regard to IFC, which is very clearly a mandate under Companies Act, and SEBI and ICOFR, which is the Internal Controls of Financial Reporting. All these are part of the global requirements of that. I mean, that's where I said the very, very good example of poor IT risk management, poor IT governance is how this income tax portal has been managed, wherein users have been stuck. So when we look at risk management as a subject and internal controls, please understand that there is an internal environment of the organization. You have to keep on setting objective. It should have a particular method of doing so. Event identification, because every event, for example, let us say some organization has come up with a new way of doing things. That's an event. Should it bother you? Yes, because that could take away your market share. So there are opportunities with regard to IT and innovation. And there are also downsides with regard to cybersecurity, the failure of IT, mismanagement of IT. Both are events in the industry as well as within your organization, which needs to be identified, because then only you can do a risk assessment and say, okay, how bad is it for me? Is it within my risk appetite? Now, what is the risk appetite? We'll see later. That, so whether it is within the risk appetite of the organization, and then if it is not, what do you need to do? You need to have a structured way of responding to that risk. And how do you do that? You do perform various control activities for which the foundation is information and communication. And obviously, a fundamental thing is to continuously monitor risk. Now, this entire thing happens, if you see on the top of this cube, for strategic requirements, operational requirements, reporting requirements, compliant requirement. And across, we see on the right hand side, the entity level, division level, subunit level, subsidiary level. So this is what we call as enterprise governance over information and technology, wherein this dimension talks about risk management of enterprise information over information and technology. Okay. Now, last slide for this chapter. What happens if EGIT fails? Let us say you are doing a bank audit. I'm sure most of you have done a bank audit, or at least you are working on a mobile application. Understand how the various parts of the processes, the IT, IT governance, everything matters to make the results what they are supposed to be. If you see in this, you see the centerpiece, which is a core banking application. But can the core banking application exist by itself? Because today you have other banking applications like mobile banking application, internet banking applications, customer relationship management, SWIFT application, then RTGS application. You got a whole lot of applications which have to interface with core banking system to really make the customer experience with regard to the various types of service expectations. But if you look at it on the top where the user sits, the user can only, the user's world of this entire IT is only the application. And the user can only do two things. For example, today, most of the loan appraisal, how is it done? Online. Because you got software which can not only do the decisioning, but also intelligent decisioning, because they have employed artificial intelligence, machine learning. So if you see, there are several kinds of questions that they can get out of you and then appropriately structure your loan, all without any manual intervention. But there are still many organizations who prefer to do a kind of hybrid role, wherein you take certain reports of performance of the customer from the system, and then you, the manager, further decides based upon several other factors. So there will be a day, obviously, all this also will become completely automated with kind of robotics and everything coming in. But when you go below the core banking software and the application software, these are the areas which are hidden, which actually form the foundation. Mind you, the pipeline that delivers water to you, you don't see that except in the tap where you get this water. But you have to understand that this is coming from somewhere and all this is hidden. But without this, can you get water? You cannot. So similarly, with regard to performance of IT, there are several components which need to work well and in an integrated manner. Here you see some of them. For example, the technical database, then the various IT infrastructure components like hardware, system software such as operating system, etc., etc. Then you have links, networks, facilities. All this are nothing but forming part of this base or the foundation. So you have policy and risk management and internal control requirements, which are the policy foundation. It forms that. And if you left hand side, if you see, that is where you are doing as a customer through channels, payment settlement, partner system, all that is happening with regard to the interactions. And if you see how this has to be run and how customer delivery is to be achieved, obviously requires significant amount of strategy, continuously making sure that strategies are translated into processes and requirements, and then those are executed in the timely manner, and that is achieved, and you have the audit and the regulatory inspection system which makes sure you are doing that properly. So this in kind of sums up key aspects of this chapter. Now, would you like to take one or two questions? I don't know if we have time, but we'll take one question at least. I'll tell you how to answer these questions. First of all, please understand this is how your DSA question looks like. So you have what is called as a stem of the question, which is on top. So you're asking this question, who is responsible for establishing right structure with regard to decision-making accountabilities? So now I'm sure how to read that question, how to read the answer. See, what happens and why you lose marks, please understand this very carefully, is because especially, you know, professionals who have been in practice or who have been in the industry for some time, our biggest problem is our familiarity and existing understanding of many of these aspects, which impulsively comes to our mind, because we, even if we know this is how it works, because we've seen it work, but that may not be the right answer. So there is a huge requirement, especially for experienced professional, to unlearn and relearn. Otherwise, what happens is that what happens in your organization is not necessarily the right answer, and you land up ticking on this and losing marks. Here, the objective is not to run your organization, is to pass in this examination, right? So you have to make sure that you're academically proficient in that. So when you take this, one of the another mistakes everybody commits is nobody reads the question properly. They simply jump to A, B, C, D, blah, 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 and then simply tick it off and go to the next question, because you feel so confident. Why? Because many of you, I either have this photographic memory of seeing it already in your question base and solving it, but more dangerously, what happens is that you're so, what you call, unattentive to the detail, that you simply just whisk through that, which is not good at all for this examination. Please read what is asked in that question, because I can twist it with just one word. So very important that you read that question carefully, then read the choices also carefully, all choices, irrespective of if they are right or not. How to read the choices? Every choice, read in the context of the question. So for example, if you are reading Chief Information Officer, ask it in the context of the question. Can the Chief Information Officer be responsible for establishing right structure of the decision-making accountabilities? You'll clearly know the answer is a no, because he himself is part of that structure. So then who can do it? You remember the role in the ship, the captain and the team that manages the various aspects. So obviously the captain only decides on the right structure of the organization. Obviously the answer, ideal answer would be the board. But since that is not the answer here, you have to now look for the next best answer, in which case the answer is senior management. So the answer is senior management. So I given an example of how to solve this question. This strategy is also equally important. And mind you, please do enough practice so that you are able to meet the timelines with regard to the examination, right? Because certain questions will take lesser time. Certain questions take more time. You don't have to rush for everything. But at the same time, please don't take either too much of time or too less time with regard to a question. Okay, I'm going to skip the other two questions in the interest of time, and go to the next chapter, which is with regard to GRC frameworks and risk management practices. So now, having understood the importance of governance over enterprise IT or enterprise governance over information and technology, now the big question is, oh my goodness, we understand it is so important, but what is the way or what is the approach to do this, or what is the approach to implement this? And that is where, if you are going to look at your rival organization or you look at another organization, well, there'll be a lot of things which are unique to them and not certainly apply to you. So all this will not work. So the best way is always go for standards which are globally acclaimed. For example, some of the very popular GRC frameworks are, you have ISO 27001, which is an information security management system standard. Then you have COBIT 2019, which is one of the most popularly referred IT governance standard or governance standard for enterprise information and technology. Then you also have ISO 31000, which is more focused on any kind of risk management. So it is a very popular risk management standard, which obviously includes aspects of governance in that. Now, you have to clearly understand the concepts of enterprise risk management with regard to the role in governance. Now, what is this enterprise risk management? So let us please understand your IFC. What are you doing? You draw up a risk and control matrix, right? Now, what do you do as part of the risks and controls matrix? What you're looking at is, what is it that can reduce the value of something in an organization or make the organization not meet its objective? So in short, risk is nothing but any undesirable event that will go to making sure you don't either meet your objectives or need not meet your objectives in the most optimal fashion. So that is where we need to very clearly understand that enterprise-wide risk management is an essential if you are looking at good governance. Risk management should happen at every layer of the organization and in turn roll up into the overall enterprise risk. A person in your organization who is managing power supply can also do a risk management. He does risk management unconsciously, but it is not done in a structured manner. So what happens is, when the person changes, the risk changes. Or when you change a system, you don't understand the new components of the system, risk of the power structure changes. So that is why please understand that with regard to everything, the risk management is a key concept and that needs to go across the enterprise. So when it comes to IT, as I said, information is the breadth of the enterprise. Your sales manager or sales head or your production head or inventory head or whosoever it may be, without information, what will you do? Nothing. So please understand that this information for every person to use for business in the most efficient manner has to be meeting the tenets of confidentiality, integrity, availability, right? Now, the risk comes with regard to confidentiality, integrity, availability, not only that, even effectiveness of the system or efficiency of the system. So for example, what is hacking? A person from somewhere in the world, a stranger, gets into your system. And he simply just, what he does is he corrupts your operating system of the server. That's all. Sadist. Imagine what happens. The kind of downtime. Imagine if you are a bank. The entire bank system would start coming down. And imagine immediately the media will be there. Such a good bank, this bank, they are completely poor in performance. In one night, whatever glory that you have built across several years, they can take it down. So that is why enterprise-wide risk management is a continuous process wherein both sides of the management are involved, the business side, the IT side, and the support side also, like the HR department, the legal department. Everybody has a role to play or a dimension to contribute when it comes to risk management. So obviously there are need for risk manager process, which you'll look at. So when we look at IS risks, as I said, the risks can come from multiple dimensions. It can also be risks like regulatory risk. For example, as we clearly see that, let us say, if you're using a GST software, right, and it has errors in that, but you trusted the previous version and you simply uploaded all the returns, imagine what chaos it will cause. You will start getting notices, penalties, all that, right? So mind you that whenever any application software and anything that has to deliver with regard to that, the entire stack comes into place. When you say stack, what does it include? the application software, the database, the hardware that you are using, the networks, the power supply, everything comes in as part of that, because failure in any one of them can cause you to not file your return on that last date, which is when we are used to filing. And therefore you enter into, let us say, the entire loss of the organization cannot be carried forward, or many consequences could be there. So it is very important that IT risk management is given due importance with regard to understanding of what kind of risks that the organization suffers from. Then of course, you got COVID 2019, we'll look at that. There is a small section on Information Technology Act and the GDPR and Personal Data Protection Act. We'll see as it goes across. Now, this is another excellent example of how lack of governance, lack of risk assessment, lack of proper processes causes such a big reputation damage and money loss to the bank. This is the case, as you see, of a banking app, UPI app, which was rolled out. The vendor made the app. Of course, very, very interestingly, the app was tested by both sides, right? It was released into the market. And within a matter of days, what, you know, they did not realize was, one of the customers he tried, he had a balance of 9,000 rupees in his account. He transferred 5,000 rupees. It got transferred. Very good. He simply tried transferring another 6,000 rupees. That also got transferred, whereas total balance available was 9,000. So then he tried another 5,000. It also got transferred. Then he tried 25,000. That also got transferred. Now this is Akshaya Patram. So he discovered that, oh my goodness, this is working. And once he was sure that it was working for him, he taught this to the entire village. And this village today stands as the crime capital of credit card fraud. It's called Jamtara, somewhere in north. You should look at a movie which has come on OTT called Jamtara, which is actually on this kind of frauds. So today, there are hubs of crime criminals, cyber criminals, which are coming up across the country. Now, in this case, what happened? Let us look at further. So in a matter of known time, the entire village made 25 crores, right, using this UPI app, or the glitch in the UPI app. It was a very simple internal control failure of not checking for the updated customer balance in the account before putting through the transaction. Now, how come this was missed out? Because it was working very well in the core banking system. This is where the governance flaw comes in. Why? Because first of all, they did not clearly understand the architecture of the entire system and where internal controls are being implemented. When integrating the system, the mobile banking or the UPI app has to integrate with the core banking application. Obviously, there has to be updates which has to go after every transaction. That was not happening. They did quality checks, but the stupid thing about their entire strategy was they did quality checks only for their parts of the application. It is so stupid. They did not test the entire integration. Nobody tested the integration part. And that is where it led to such a big fraud. All because of poor IT governance. It's a classic case of application level IT governance missing. So that is where a standard like COBIT is very popular. Why COBIT is popular? Because it clearly gives you the guidance of how anyone can go about building their own IT governance framework. While this is a little busy slide, but all it tries to tell you is, if you see, it considers everything while building your information technology framework. For example, the standards, frameworks, regulations that are applied to you, the expectations of various stakeholders, or what ideas people will have with regard to that, everything is considered. Then it goes into a framework system. So the framework, what does it ensure? It ensures that various aspects like stakeholder needs are met. It can be implemented end to end with regard to an organization. So there are several aspects you look at a little later, which is called as some of the principles and components of the governance system. So then, if you really look at it, all this is to achieve the IT's day-to-day job. And all the jobs that are done under IT have been classified under 38 different process domains, right? And that is the central cube that you see. We'll see that later in a bigger picture. But you have everything, as I said, from EDM to everything that the executive management has to do, operational management has to do, everything comes in there. Everything with regard to IT, including innovation, everything comes in there. But that is where, if you see, in building this system for your organization to customize it, you have to consider what is called as design factors. What are they? Like enterprise strategy, your enterprise goals, your enterprise size, which enterprise segment do you operate in? What is the role of IT in your organization? What is your sourcing model for IT? What are the compliance requirements? The list goes on. But all these are factored into tailoring your IT governance system. So just remember that all these are inputs for factoring the IT governance system. And you can also build it for specific area. Like, I don't want the entire IT governance system. I want only for security governance. You can do that if you want, because that is a major concern. And all that obviously gives you priority governance management. Objectives are fixed, so you get quite clear capability of where you are going. Everything happens on that. So if you look at framework and controls, now we come to the next framework, which is ISO 27001. Is the most popular management system for information security. And what all does it encompass? There are two parts to this entire document, the standard. The first one is the framework. The framework clearly defines these aspects which are given here, 10 in number. Number one, you have to be clear with defining the scope of the ISMS and also be clear with the terms and definitions. Because in certain industry like stock exchanges, rolling settlement, it has its own definition. And when the rolling settlement is automated, it is driven through an algorithm. So all that needs to be defined properly with regard to your organization. Then look at internal and external issues which may be relevant for the business. Then look at how the top management will support all this, both in terms of fund, in terms of involvement, in terms of support. All this is extremely important, because without the top management involvement and demonstrative leadership, no good governance can happen across. It will only remain a copybook implementation. Then how the organization creates actions to address the various risks. So that is where clearly deciding on your risk management procedure, which needs to be in place. Then securing the rights, resources, right people, the right infrastructure, etc. is also extremely important, because let us say you are going in for an implementation of mobile banking system and you're not even budgeted for security. You can imagine what is a big fiasco it will be, right? How the plans and processes will be executed, including documentation that needs to be produced. So everything needs to be planned. Similarly here, information security also needs to be planned, and it needs to be process oriented. Right from aspects like information security budgets also need a process. Then of course you have how the organization will monitor, measure, analyze each of these achievements with regard to various dimensions is where you require a measurement system, or you need a system of dashboards. And last but not the least, wherever we have found any unacceptable results, how do we take corrective action and put it on the course of continuous improvement? So for example, if your firewall is not stopping all threats, daily 5 or 6 threats are passing through, and it could be quietly sitting in your system. So important to even measure that. Just because there is no incident, you cannot leave that unmeasured, because that will tell you in the future what kind of problem could happen. And this is the second part of the standard, or part A of the standard, as they say. And this deals with the various controls. In fact, it covers several dimensions of operational security of any organization. For example, it covers need for information security policies, what they should cover, at what level they should be done, etc., etc. It also looks at what is the required organization roles, responsibilities with regard to various aspects in the policy, which is what is covered down under how to secure security of human resources. This is very important. For example, whether background check a database administrator is a very important, because we say database administrator is more powerful than a cashier in an organization. Please understand. So he can cause significant damage. Suppose he is planted by a rival. What do you do? So that is one aspect of background as a check is one aspect of human resource security. Not only that, like what role to give to which person in the system, your delegation of authority matter will say something. But whether that is what is implemented through the system's application is important. Otherwise, in a bank, if you carefully see, even the junior employees will have sanction powers. So that is not the right thing to do. So it is job of the human resources to ensure that they have access to only the right kind of powers. Then asset management, obviously, unless and until you have a listing or an inventory of all IT assets and information asset, can you protect them or manage them? You can't. So that is a need for an asset management process. Then access control system, which will ensure that obviously all kinds of access in only according to need to know, need to do. Then you have cryptography, which takes care of encryption of transmission lines and making sure that your data in transit, data where it is residing is encrypted, etc., etc. Then physical and environmental security with regard to work areas, with regard to data centers, with regard to power enclosures, etc. is also covered here. Then you have operational security aspects, which covers various several aspects, right from backup operations to looking at end of day operation, then administration operation, everything is covered as part of operational security. Then you have communication security, which deals with network communication, last mile communication, mobile communication. All that also needs a lot of securing because today the mobiles are the biggest threat in work from home. And mind you, it requires tremendous amount of VPN, which works right over, you know, uncertain internet connections and all that organizations, they could be completely dispersed staff. So all that comes as part of the communication security. Then 10 deals with the aspects with regard to systems development security, which is in security in development of software. Mind you, here's an example. A rogue developer, a person who is developing a program, he can insert a small piece into your organization code. This is an actual incident. If my name is not there in the payroll database, delete all databases. So what will happen? The day this person is pushed out of the organization or asked to go, and his name obviously gets removed from the payroll database, no database will work. He has programmed it like that. So imagine the risk. This is just one small example of risk. There are several, several risks, which I'm sure will be covered as part, which covered in your manual, this background material. Then supplier relationship. Obviously, if you take a banking, mobile banking transaction on which you are buying grocery or buying something, please understand, imagine the number of partners, the mobile developer, the payment gateway hosting company, Visa, MasterCard, your bank, your merchant, everybody is a partner or a supplier, as we say, what is called as the IT supply chain as part of that. So all of them also need to be secure. Otherwise, your bank is secure. What does it matter? Doesn't matter. Because some one fellow is insecure, he'll make the entire one fish can poison the whole pond, as they say. And then you need a very, very robust information security incident management system, because if something goes wrong, what to do should be very clear. And where such an incident threatens the business continuity, you need a very strong business continuity management system. And last but not the least is a very strong compliance system, which ensures compliance with all applicable regulations. I was just going to ask, do we require a break? I don't know how it works. Mr. Rao?
No, sir. 2 hours only, no?
Yeah, yeah. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah.
Okay.
Another 15 minutes, we have to wind up, no, sir. Already it's 10:15.
Oh, I see. Okay. Okay, so I think I'll have to skip some of these portions and get into that. So this 38,500, you can read only in all that kind of looks at the purpose with regard to why do we need this with regard to promoting effective, efficient, acceptable use of IT in all organizations and assuring stakeholders, governing bodies and organizations, they are all meeting this. So that's where it kind of amplifies whatever we had discussed. It's the same thing you can read on, because that only talks about ISO, another framework, which is ISO 38,500. Now, this also is ISO 31,000, which deals with the process of how to manage risk. which deals with, as you see, number in this diagram, it is very clear. Like you have number one, which is continuous communication and consulting across the organization, establishing the context, establishing, identifying the risk, analyzing the risk, evaluating the risk, treating the risk. So, and then continuously monitoring that. So this is the entire process of risk management as such. Because it talks about several aspects of risk being connected, wherein IT risks comes in as part of anything that you do today. And then as part of various definitions, you need to be clear about all these definitions. You have risk appetite. It is nothing but, for example, today, if I say, how many of you are ready to go for, let us say, adventure sport? Many of us may not have the appetite. So similarly, organizations, every organization has an appetite for risk, which can differ. For example, a public sector bank will have a different risk appetite to a private sector bank. So that is what is another part of risk appetite. Risk tolerance is, given that risk appetite, how much more or less risk I'm prepared to take, which is a margin across that threshold. So risk scenario analysis is important because you understand if there is an attack, then how will our organization get affected? Then threats, which are both external and internal, need to be understood. As I said, the threat is the one that causes the damage. For example, hacker or the earthquake or the pandemic. And then you look at the vulnerabilities that it can take advantage of. So for example, when people are working from home, they are working on insecure Wi-Fi. So all that the hackers can take advantage of. And then comes the question of how likelihood that we will get attacked, or if they are attacked, what is the consequence? So this is a very important function which determines the risk profile. And then you decide, okay, what do we do with that now? Either I accept the risk or transfer the risk, like taking insurance or outsourcing, or mitigate the risk, like I put in all the controls in place, or simply avoid that what is causing the risk. So therefore, once you decide to mitigate, you have to look at controls. And there are several kinds of controls. The key, of course, is preventive, detective, and corrective controls, which I am sure has been spoken about. And please understand, everything has an inherent risk. What is inherent risk? Suppose, can you have a scorpion as a pet? Why you can't have? Because it has an inherent risk wherein it will keep on biting you, isn't it? A dog also bites, but the dog will not bite in the same manner, isn't it? So you have to look at the inherent risk of every system and what is the damage it can cause. And hence look at what is the residual risk that, because in business or when you're using IT, you have to understand there is nothing called a zero risk. So you only accept, have an acceptable level of risk. And every risk needs an owner so that they are focused on it and they are in turn able to control it. And it has to be all aggregated across the organization, which results in the heat map. The heat map is nothing but which tells you what is high risk, medium risk, low risk. This is the heat map, right? So nothing but it's a combination of likelihood and consequence. So regulations, you have IT Act. Please read section 43A very carefully and 66, 66F. All these are important sections wherein you can get information, questions. The SPDI, which is sensitive personal data and information, is also a very important concept which can be tested. So it is nothing but there are 8 key different kind of information which are considered as SPDI. All you need to understand is that SPDI comes under section 43, covers under section 43A to say if these are not properly protected, what kind of damage can happen, what are the consequences, what is the penalties. Then globally, you have the General Data Protection Regulation, which is primarily European, but mind you, which can also impact you if you have European customers. And you have to be clear about the penalties, because sometimes they can test you on the penalties. Like the fines can range between 10 million euro or 2% of global turnover, annual turnover, to 20 million or 4%, whichever is higher. On the same lines, we are getting the Personal Data Protection Bill, which is in the parliament, which is not yet become an act. I don't expect any questions out of that. So unfortunately, we don't have time for these questions. Just slightly quickly go through certain key aspects of chapter 3, 4, and 5. Maybe I'll take another 10, 15 minutes. So what are the key? Many of them we have covered earlier. So I'm just going to go through, take you on this. For example, in this chapter, provide a stakeholder value. I already told about what it is. Holistic approach, looking at the entire picture. I told you what it is. Dynamic governance. So obviously, we said we constantly do that, right? You have to look at continuous governance is a continuous process. And how is governance distinct from management? I gave you the ship example. and how do you tailor to the enterprise needs? I told you about the design factors. And how do you make sure you have end-to-end governance system where I said everything in the enterprise needs to be covered is what it is. So if you really look at the left-hand side of this, which is dealing with the principles of governance system, this is something important for you. Of course, just for academic purposes, right-hand side, the principle of governance is based on a complex conceptual model, and you have open and flexibility and aligned to major standards. Like COBIT is a typical model of that. And then you build your own governance system. What are the principles? What will it deliver? What it should deliver? Number one, provide stakeholder value. If you are enjoying your experience with Amazon, with Indian Railways, with regard to your digital services, you should know that they have been looking at this stakeholder value provision correctly. Second, holistic approach, which means it should address the dimension not only for customer level, but also for employees, etc., vendors, everybody's concern is taken into consideration or expectations are taken into consideration. So even, for example, a leave app is also a part of making sure there is a good experience with regard to that. And as I said, dynamic governance system, wherein there is a frequency of meetings of how much the governance bodies meet, how the dashboards keep on kicking in the data. All this is also part of dynamic governance. The governance as distinct from management, which I already told you, is nothing but where the governance has a role of the captain of the ship, evaluate, direct and monitor. And this rest of the aspect is all done by the management, which is the executive management of the organization. And everything needs to be tailored to the enterprise needs. You are a bank, your entire IT governance will be different. If you are Amazon, your entire IT governance is different. If you are a stock exchange, your entire IT governance is different, needless to say. So all this gets factored or tailored to the enterprise needs, and it has to work end to end. You cannot say my data center alone has IT governance. You can't do that because you have to work end to end. So this is what I explained each of these governance principles. And if you look at the components of governance, what is important to make governance successful? And in this case, IT governance, please see this. One, you need clear policies, principles, procedures, very clearly defined. So that is what you see on the right-hand side. You see that principles, policies, and procedures. Then you need to have an inventory of all the information in the organization, because that's what you're managing. And the information about risk is also an information. Then very important, culture, ethics, and behavior. You cannot say top management alone can connect in airport, all others should not connect. No, that is not demonstrative leadership. So you have to set an example, leadership by example. So that is very important. And also sharing passwords, for example, culturally, you should make sure that it's not done. Culturally, you should make sure that security comes first. Then people skills and competencies, making sure for IT at the senior most level, with this the CISO level, then at the board level, independent directors, then at the various management level, then at the risk level, then at the operative levels, everywhere your people, they are skilled, their competencies are very clearly defined. And then look at all the service infrastructure in, applications that are delivering, because that is what you need to also continuously improve upon. But that are the means of delivery of this governance. And then you have processes and organization structures, which obviously bring in a lot of standardization, consistency in the way that these processes need to be done and who will do it. For example, take a simple thing like taking a backup of the server. It requires discipline. It requires making sure you are clear what is being backed up, in what media it is backed up, when to change the media. So all this is defined as a process. This is an example. So I told you about the various aspects of IT. What all needs processes, whatever you saw in the previous screen, all that applies to each of them here. So I'm not going into the details of that. You can see that. But the top one is EDM, Evaluate, Direct, Monitor, which is the role of the board. And the bottom three are with regard to the executive management, which deals with aligning, planning, organizing your information technology, building out your entire infrastructure, application, et cetera, service capability, then acquiring any software or technology or people or whatever processes and implementing them and making sure on a constant pace it is run, which is deliver service and support. And mind you, on the right hand side, you see the monitoring, evaluate, and assurance, which is, as you see the very function, it is overseeing these so that it independently evaluates and seeing whether the objectives are being achieved. Now, one more aspect is implementing a tailored governance system. How to implement a governance system? It is fairly simple. It is this journey of where you are today. For example, I am having very poor IT governance today. So I am at a level of zero. How do I want to move? I can move up to five because it is based on the CMMI model, zero to five. So you cannot jump from zero to five overnight. It is a process. Today, I don't understand mathematics. Tomorrow morning, you cannot become a biscuit, isn't it? It is a process which takes time. Year on year, you start strengthening and you become expert. So this is what, if you see in this wheel, it talks about. If you see number one is what are the drivers with regard to implementation? Two, where are we now? So why did we at all require IT governance is the question that is answered there. Where are we now with regard to IT governance? And that is answered at three levels with regard to the various levels of the achievement within the organization. And then looks at where do we want to go? So, okay, this is where we are. Then we want to go. Then decide what needs to be done to get there and how do we get there? Okay, so you are now defining to say, okay, this is what needs to be done to get to, let us say, if a bank is there and they are saying that we don't have any digital banking today. Okay, this is all what needs to be done over this plan, these technologies, these approaches, and over this period of time. And then to independently answer number six, did we get there or not? But if we are not getting there, then obviously we need to correct the course and go again. And last but not the least, make sure that the momentum is kept up, you're continuously improving and not falling. So this is how the entire implementation of IT governance systems take place. There's a small chapter on performance management systems. It's a very simple chapter because it deals, as I said, with measurement of performance. Again, I've already dealt with. Now there are two levels. One is, as I said, at an outcome level. That is at the business goal level. You remember we said goal setting. If you'll see, it comes number three, because goal setting is important. Ultimately, the outcome of whatever you are doing is important. You cannot say I have become an expert in programming unless and until you're able to make a difference to the lives of people. So expert in programming means, okay, performance indicator, but how is it going to impact the lives of people is what is more important. So goal setting or key goal indicators are what tells you whether all this that you are doing with regard to IT is actually delivering at the business level or not with regard to the expectations set out. So that is why important to first clearly define our expectations and then start. It also helps benchmarking with others to say, okay, how much and all. You have this small thing called streptometer. You put it, or it is there in your mobile also. The number of steps you are taking keeps on measuring. How does it help? One, of course, it's providing a measurement mechanism, but it also tells you if you are having diabetes, walk so many steps. So it kind of, is it making a difference to your diabetes is the question under goal, right? Achievement. So that is why you are always looking at strategic goals with regard to strategic, operational, reporting, and compliance issues, and all of them need measurement, right? There are two kind of outcomes that can come. One, I am proactively measuring. Which means, see, when you're going on a long ride with the family, you are seeing that the petrol is not enough. Maybe we have half tank. What will you do? It's a lead indicator for you. Immediately go to the nearest petrol pump, you plan for it and you fill up, right? Lag indicators. What is it? Oh, the entire family going on a vacation stop because there is no petrol. Your meter is not working. Imagine what kind of a mess it will make of your holiday, right? So that is reactive, which is called as lag indicators. So lag indicators are generally after the damage has occurred, after the event has occurred, whereas lead indicators are pointing to saying that, okay, this is risky, this has a good potential to happen. So that is why you have to define metrics. How will you measure? For example, number of times that we have received customer complaints with regard to mobile banking, with regard to each of the screens. Would be a very good indicator to tell you, oh my goodness, customers are facing problems in these areas. Then you have to get down to performance indicators. How did it pass the quality test and look at all that? So that is how it again goes and ties back. There is one aspect of business balance scorecard and IT balance scorecard. It is nothing but simply looking at with regard to the total investment in IT. Obviously, whenever there is investment, every management is concerned, is it delivering or not? Is there return on investment or not? But mind you, IT is the only area which is very difficult to measure. For example, you implement an ERP. Can you tell me what is the parameter to measure that this ERP is delivering results for business? There is no specific parameter, and that is why the management doesn't understand. Should we keep this going or not keep this going? If you don't invest in IT, it's a problem. If you invest in IT, there is no measurement. So that is why Jim Kaplan, he came up with this balanced scorecard, which is now applied to IT. This is more specifically with regard to IT governance. So with regard to the investment in an ERP, you will question financial aspect. Okay, how much was the profitability then? How much is the profitability now? Okay, no change in profitability. How much was the cost of operations then? What is the cost of operations now? So you'll be able to very clearly benchmark things to say, okay, when we started this project, this is where we are. Now we are here. Similarly, customer experience level, you can do a survey and find out what customer feel about that. Similarly, internal process, whether efficiency has improved, productivity has improved, whether you got better compliance, etc. Then learning and growth. Are we continuously innovating as compared to before? So these are the four dimensions. You can study more about them, of course, in your material. Then there is one more model that they have taken, even though it doesn't relate to IT, but for examination purposes, you can just read through. It's a very simple model from SEMA, which is nothing but a tool which will help the boards to fulfill their responsibilities with regard to the overall strategic effectiveness. So that is where it simply talks about how to give the oversight with regard to strategic processes, how to deal with choices with regard to strategic decision making, and how do we make sure that transformational change is achieved. Give a true and fair view of company strategic positioning, track the various actions, and make sure that it is incorporated into the processes, etc. is what it does. Come to the last chapter. I'll just take about 10-15 minutes to cover some of the key aspects here. Of course, this picture, which is from your, all these pictures are, most of them are from only your material. So this picture, again, graphic tells you what all is there under business continuity management. Very simple. Let us say you are signing the balance sheet, financial balance sheet of a company. What is the fundamental assumption? It is a going concern. Yes. If it is not a going concern, obviously, you know that the auditor has to qualify. Now, let us say after you sign, the entire database has been corrupted and there is no backup. And let us say it's a somewhat a medium sized bank. Now, can the bank survive? Is it not a going concern issue? So that is where it is now a IT business continuity management issue and requires as much importance as any other aspect. So this is deal. The entire subject deals with availability of information. That is where if you really look at this entire thing, it deals with having an what is called as a business continuity framework, right? Then obviously every place for common thinking and making sure the management intent is applied and everybody works consistently, you have policies, strategies, and procedures. Then you have the management aspects with regard to like CISO, CRO, chief risk officer, right? Risk professionals, you've got a risk management team, security team. So all that comes as part of risk management team and etc. Then you have business continuity team, which obviously also has to do significant amount of work in making out the plans and validating and testing. There is a testing team. So all that happens out of that. And then you have aspects of the infrastructure, like the recovery process, the alternate sites, etc. We'll look at some of them. These are some of the very favorite, things of examiners, the terminologies on which they can test you. What is business continuity management? How is it different from disaster recovery? Please understand, business continuity is ultimately the largest subject to say that you have to continue business whatever happens. Disaster recovery means once there is a breakdown of IT, what needs to be done to quickly get it back to business so that the business is not affected. So please understand the two and the difference between the two very clearly. There are, of course, umpteen number of definitions given in your book. Then the important aspect of business impact analysis. This business impact analysis is that important fulcrum which ties what can happen to a business and which resource in IT is important. For example, if let us say WhatsApp goes down for your organization, what is the damage? It depends upon how much of WhatsApp you use. Today, of course, every organization simply uses WhatsApp. But let us twist the question. What if the security risk of the WhatsApp increases, or you know WhatsApp already has a security risk? What if your organization data is leaked So this is again a question that you have to do business impact analysis and see, oh my goodness, this could be so dangerous. Now the big question comes is, if there is no WhatsApp, what do we use? Because now everybody has got used to so much of efficiency using WhatsApp. So all this comes as question of continuity, impact, and how to really work out the options. And then risk assessment. Okay, now having said that, okay, WhatsApp is important. What are all the risks surrounding WhatsApp? So that is where you come across, okay, WhatsApp goes down, our communication goes down. Or if there is, let us say WhatsApp is banned from India, then what happens? You recently saw that, right? So all these are risk assessment aspects with regard to those which are critical to business. Now for the risk, this risk is what we have to prepare. And always please understand, when let us say the IT department portal has fallen now, it is not working. What is the maximum allowable outage? Actually zero. Because people have to file returns and there is a last date. Now what is the department now required to do? They have to take the unfortunate reputation risk of changing, again moving the deadlines because of the failure of IT, right? Then another very important thing called what the RTO and RPO, recovery time objective and recovery point objective. What is recovery time objective? From the time you go down, how much time can you afford to recover back, or how much time will you take? So obviously it has to be within the maximum allowable outage. In this case, allowable outage is zero. So which means that you have to have concurrent systems which will keep on. If this system goes down, that system will take over. So RTO typically is zero. But in a departmental store, you may say RTO is 5 days, 10 days, or with regard to payroll system, even in a bank, you can say, well, we can do it after 10 days. So even within 10 days, if the system comes back, your RTO is achieved. What is RPO? RPO is more dangerous. Unless and until you have the data till the last day IT was working, how can you even proceed with processing? Let us say attendance data is completely lost. How can you process payroll? So RPO is the point up to which the data should be available or is available is a measurement, right? So this is RTO, RPO and MAO, maximum allowable outage, which I explained. Then risk scenario analysis today is the most prominent, and that is done obviously, which helps. Risk scenario analysis helps to look at risk from a multiple perspective and prepare for them. That's the simplest thing you have to understand. Then you have incident detection respond, which is very important because what is an incident? Incident is anything that is unpleasant, which is going to either impact your operations or has the potential to do that. And once it is there, obviously you have to report it, but then certain incidents may be the shape of a disaster. So what is a disaster? Which obviously causes a disruption to the business, or it completely shuts down your business. So you have to see if an incident can result, can become a disaster. So it could start, for example, as a very small infection of one of your systems, and then you find it's a ransomware attack, which can completely take over the entire system. So that is where you have to look at whether, first of all, incidents, whether they are detected at the right time. So you have to obviously have all the technology and processes to detect them, and then how to respond to that. And obviously to look at recovery planning. And what are the phases of a disaster? For example, there's a crisis phase, which is when everything goes wrong. Like when you have a flood, okay, and everything is up, everything in your home is underwater. So crisis phase. So during that phase is the most important to save people, save all this, make sure that all critical assets are, and it is a panic situation. Therefore, the preparation is very important. Then emergency response phase, wherein you start responding, okay, how to put back the operations together, how to at least make sure, get the people who are affected to the hospital. So all that is the next level. The third level is the recovery phase, wherein you are now trying to go back to business as usual. And then the restoration phase, when you actually take this business back to that, and that is where you get it out of the crisis phase. There are very important questions can come with regard to certain technical aspects. In fact, this entire module, this particular chapter only has certain technical aspects. For example, backup strategies. What are the different kind of backup strategies that you can read? It's a very simple thing in the booklet. And types of backup, like full backup, differential backup, incremental backup, mirror backup. Again, this is a very kind of frequently asked question. Simply just try to understand, it is nothing but the last full backup taken. either you can daily take, keep on taking full backup, but you know it is a very, very time consuming thing. It involves a lot of resources. So you can either go in for differential or incremental backup, which either is taking only changed files or added files, or looking at the changes over time and only doing that. So that is the differential and incremental backup. And mirror is nothing but simply mirroring, taking the entire thing and mirroring from time to time, which is nothing but creating a absolute replica of that. And one of the things obviously we'll see is hot site, warm site, cold site, which is covered in the next coming thing. Then building infrastructure resiliency also equally important. Fault tolerance. If for example, your router comes down, which is a core router of your organization, immediately you should have another router which is alternatively available and available in what is called as high availability mode, which is can take over this entire operations. So it applies to every critical component in communication, facility, computing equipment, mobiles, etc., then people, everywhere you need redundancy. In fact, during this pandemic, when people are affected, the clearing operations were very severely affected. But what the banks did, they took up entire hotel and they converted them into a clearinghouse system. And from there, they established a completely quarantined clearinghouse unit. Then storage redundancy, similarly, if you, let us say your entire hard disk goes off, it's a very dangerous thing. So it can be because of a power shortage or power spike, or it could be because of several reasons that the hard disk may get corrupted. So there are various technologies. One of the popular technologies is called as RAID, redundant array of inexpensive disks. There are six types of implementations, which is called as RAID 0 to RAID 5. I don't think all that is tested in your examination, fortunately, but you just need to know that it is a method by which even when your disk, some part is corrupted, or bad sectors are there, it can recover from other sectors, because that is how the information is recorded. So when we say redundant array of investment, there are several disks. The information is written across disks. So that is how it is done, so that you can recover this information because there are replications right across in different manners. Then another very popular thing is remote or journal vaulting. What happens in this case is, every transaction that is done on your mobile app will not only be recorded to your core or primary core banking server, immediately also written to the DR server or remote server. So every transaction, the DRP BCP is completed in the transaction itself. Otherwise, the transaction doesn't go through. Another method is multiple database shadowing, wherein you make several copies of the database in several places. So even if one entire geography goes down, you can get it from another geography. So that is the concept which also brings in what is called as near DR site and far DR site. So that one is immediately pick up from a nearby. If the entire zone is affected due to earthquake or floods or something like that, then you can go to the far site. Then these are very common, very, very popular area of examination questions. Hot site, warm site, cold site, mobile site. This is very easy. You can please study in your background material. All you need to understand is the difference is only saying that, can I readily switch from the current primary to the backup site? And if that can be done, that is a hot site. If you cannot do, you have to now buy equipment, now buy computers, you have to put the software, all that, that's a cold site. In between is a warm site. A mobile site is nothing but, today we have entire data centers which are carried on a truck or a huge, like your cinema shooting, right? So we have similar data centers which can also be made available in affected areas for a brief period. Then testing of BCP and DR is obviously extremely important, and it's a very easy area. You can please look at it. You have to only be careful about the types of testing approaches. Desktop walkthrough, then you have simulation, then you have a cutoff drill. So all these are very important. The global standard for business continuity management system is 22301. I'm sorry, I'm not going to go through this example, but we are kind of finished. So if there are any questions or anything, please let me know, because I also got to be leaving for another session, or we can take the questions later. Back to Mr. Rao.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you. So Dwarkanath Acharya, sir, posted a question, sir, in the chat box.
Yeah. how to enhance skill gap and advisory. Sorry, can you, sir, can you?
Yes, sir. I'll read.
Yeah.
How to enhance.
Hello.
1 minute, sir.
How to enhance skills gap and advisory assignments? How artificial intelligence based production systems are deployed with new generation technology types?
Yeah. See, how to enhance skill gaps and advisory advisory assignment. What do you mean by advisory assignment? Can you please just tell me?
Acharya sir, please unmute and please ask the speaker. Dwarkanath Acharya sir, are you there?
Dwarkanath, are there? Okay, let me answer this. See, skill gaps, obviously, first you need to know what is the gap, then only you can fill the gap, right? And then, what is the target? Which is the role that you are going to play? Obviously, you should know a very clear understanding of where your firm is going, where your career is going. And using that, I mean, there is a publication also from the DAAB, as you know, with regard to the strategy for IT strategy for firms, which has been released in January. You can read through that. That gives the answer to how to enhance skill gap. And this advisory assignment, I'm not able to understand. So what exactly you mean here? But there are several, obviously, where if you're looking at IT related, there are huge opportunities which are obviously there. Unless you have the IT knowledge, you cannot penetrate that. Then how AI based protection systems are deployed in new gen tech attacks. Yes, there are a lot. Hackers also use AI for attacking, and their protection systems also use AI for protecting. So it is now become a war of that kind. So AI and machine learning is widely used in several of these systems for both attacks and protection against attacks. So especially AI ML are the most popular in that. Not only that, there are several aspects of modeling which are coming up, blockchain based protection, which is also coming up.
Okay, thank you, sir. Vote of thanks by our speaker, I mean, Treasurer Nutrapat Amarnath.
So my request is, if you have any questions, please put it on that chat, the WhatsApp created by the chapter. I'll try to answer that.
Okay, sir.
Okay,
good evening. Good morning to all the members. Myself Amarnath Nutrapati, Treasurer of Guntur branch. I am thanking you. I am giving thanks to Vittal Raj sir, today's speaker, for sharing of his excellent knowledge and excellent elaborative explanation on governance, enterprise risk management, and risk optimization, business continuity management, and disaster recovery planning. All these things. I hope all the participants are also has equipped with the knowledge and ready to the AT exam. And I hope all the participants has utilized the opportunity of the knowledge resource person, Sri Vittal Raj Garu's knowledge. And I am thanking all the participants who are patiently listening two hours, more than 200 plus attendance. Okay. It is a great achievement by Guntur branch, I think. And I am thanking to Changal Reddy Garu, regional council member, and ex officio of Guntur branch. I am thanking all the participants and today's seminar speaker, Vittal Raj Garu, for sharing the knowledge and listening of the and all the other participants for listening and spending time of gaining knowledge of on this DISA IT. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I hope the session was useful. But of course, always please do get back in case there are any points which are not clear.
Yes, sir.
I know the time was constrained. 2 hours covering the entire chapter is a little bit of problem. And this is kind of a slimy subject, as I say. So anyway, thanks to you all for attending.
We enjoyed, a lot, sir. We enjoyed a lot.
And all the participants, please raise questions in WhatsApp.
Thank you, Vittal Raj sir. I think the participants can post their questions in the WhatsApp group so that Vittal Raj sir can answer whenever you go through that question particularly. Kindly, you make use of this WhatsApp group. Whoever is having any doubts with respect to the DISA IT exam, please kindly post without hesitation all the your queries into that WhatsApp group, so that the speaker, either Vetora sir or TKR and the other speaker also can able to answer your queries. This is my
All the group members are asking for when will be the AT exam. Please update them as and when.
As far as the ET and AT examination are concerned, yesterday when I spoke to CAT secretary, categorically told that recently we have conducted the ET exam. Most probably there may not be any ET exam with respect to the current scenario. Mostly they are going for AT in the month of either August. June, July end or August, probably their dates are not yet announced by the CIT committee.
Please update of members, sir, rather than you know.
Yeah, with respect to the examination, what is suggested is, with respect to the ET, next two attempts will be there for old syllabus. AT, three attempts will be there. This is what he categorically told yesterday. Yes, sir.
I request if I can be relieved so that I had to go for another session.
Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you very much for joining Gundur branch. Thank you.
Namaskar.
Thank you.
This is what yesterday told by CAT secretary.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, all the members.
Can you call it today?
Yeah, okay. We'll call up for that. Thank you, all the members.